Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we will cover chemical shift and how we can interpret chemical shift in the proton NMR. So chemical shift is basically where a signal shows up in the spectrum. So for a proton NMR, you're looking at a chemical shift range of about 0 to 12. And this is a different spectrum, so the units are parts per million, and we'll talk about why that is on the next slide here. But if we think about what we're doing when we introduce our sample into the NMR, we're applying a magnetic field to the sample. And the magnetic field that is felt by the sample influences where on the spectrum the signal will show up. So we can kind of think of it as the magnetic field felt, so B felt, B for magnetic field, is equal to the magnetic field that's applied by the instrument, which is the large magnetic field, and then influenced by the characteristics of the neighboring atoms. So the neighboring atoms can either add to or subtract from the applied magnetic field, and those small differences in chemical environments make for a difference in chemical shift. And that's handy for us because that separates our signals out from one another and allows us to interpret them more easily. So again, here's my chemical shift range for the proton NMR between about 0 and 12. The right-hand side of the spectrum with the smaller numbers we refer to as upfield. And the signals that show up in this area are described as shielded, which means that the influence of the neighbors is such that less of the magnetic field is felt. So B felt would be smaller because of the impact of the neighbors. As you move to the other side, the left-hand side where we have the bigger numbers, this is described as downfield, and these protons would be called deshielded, and the neighbors are influencing it in such a way that B felt is larger. So those nuclei experience a larger magnetic field and therefore have a larger chemical shift. So as I mentioned previously, the parts per million is a difference, and that is with respect to this reference molecule here, tetramethylsilane, which is sometimes called TMS. So commonly NMR solvents are spiked with a little bit of TMS, and then the spectrometer sets that value to 0 ppm, and then we reference all of our other peaks off of that. The reason that this works is because carbon is more electronegative than silicon, and we rarely see carbon as the more electronegative atom in an organic molecule. And so these H's here have a lot of electron density around them. Those electrons are spinning and generating their own little induced magnetic fields, and those magnetic fields are in opposition to the magnetic field that's applied. So that shielding effect, having a lot of electron density around those protons, makes B felt smaller. It shields those protons and they show up very upfield. So pretty much any organic molecule that we might be looking at would show up downfield from that. So that allows us to have a reference point that we use sort of across the board in organic chemistry that doesn't interfere with the peaks that we might be looking at because it's upfield of all of those. I've zoomed in on the top part of the proton NMR spectrum here, so between 0 and 5 parts per million. This part is predominantly influenced by diamagnetic shielding, which is essentially how much electron density is around any given proton, basically through the environment of the sigma bonds that are around that particular proton. So we're looking at all H's that are on carbons that are sp3 hybridized. Now remember, in the proton NMR, the only signal you're seeing is from a proton, but the atoms that are attached to it and next door to it are going to be influencing where exactly that chemical shift occurs. And we can break this range down a little bit further by looking at how those neighbors influence that chemical shift. So we're looking at a hydrogen, remember, only the proton signals are going to show up. And between about 0 and 2 ppm, that hydrogen is on a carbon that is next door to another carbon that is probably sp3 hybridized. So if it's around just a bunch of carbons attached to carbons, it's going to be more up on the 0 to 1 range. If the carbon next door has some other kind of heteroatom attached to it, it'll be more down towards 2. So essentially, the more electron withdrawing the neighbor is, the less electron density there is around that molecule. So the smaller that opposing field is, and the more that is going to move. So B felt gets bigger. Between about 2 and 3 ppm, you're looking at hydrogens that are attached to carbons, and the next door neighbor carbon is going to be sp2 hybridized. So maybe a carbonyl compound or a benzene ring, or it could be a less electronegative heteroatom. So it could also have a neighbor like a nitrogen or a sulfur, something that's not quite as electronegative. And then downfield past about 3, again, we're looking at a carbon that has a hydrogen on it. And the next door, it's probably directly connected to X, to a heteroatom. And the more electronegative that heteroatom is, the further downfield it's going to appear. So fluorine being the most electronegative is, would be like the closest to 5. And then more between 3 and 4 would be oxygen. And then between 3 and 2, like we discussed, would be even less electronegative atoms like nitrogen or sulfur. So remember, we're looking at signals from protons. Those are going to be attached to carbons. In this case, for this chemical shift range, sp3 hybridized carbons, the chemical shift itself is being influenced by the neighbor. So between 0 and about 2, you have very likely a carbon that is sp3 hybridized as the neighboring carbon atom. Between about 2 and 3, you have a carbon that is sp2 hybridized as the neighbor, and then like a nitrogen or a sulfur. So for sp2 hybridization, you maybe are thinking about a carbonyl compound, or maybe they're next door to a benzene ring. Those are some common sp2 type neighbors. And then as you get even more deshielded, they're going to be directly attached to a heteroatom like a fluorine or an oxygen that moves it downfield. So now we'll take a look at the bottom half of a typical chemical shift range for a proton NMR. The predominant factor that influences chemical shift here is actually pi systems, and so it's different than the diamagnetic influences that we saw earlier. So between about 7 and maybe 5.5, you'll see protons that are directly coming off of a double bond, so not next door neighbors to a carbon that has a double bond, but directly coming off of the double bond itself. And then between about 7 and 8, those protons are coming off of a benzene ring, so a more conjugated system. And then the only thing that shows up downfield from that is aldehydes and carboxylic acids. So this proton is directly attached to the carbonyl carbon. This oxygen is pulling a lot of electron density up and away from that carbon. So that proton is very, very deshielded, and as a result shows up pretty far downfield. And then even lower than that, between about 11 and 12, is the proton on a carboxylic acid. These are fairly acidic protons, and so they don't always show up. They can sometimes exchange with the NMR solvent, which is deuterated, so as to not interfere with the signal. And so we don't always see them. But both of these are incredibly deshielded protons because the carboxylic acid proton is directly attached to an oxygen, and the aldehyde proton is directly attached to the carbonyl carbon. So the chemical shift of these protons that are directly attached to carbons that are part of the pi system, those are deshielded because of that pi system. So when we think about B felt, remember, that was the combination of B naught plus B from the neighbors. And in this case, it's really that pi system that is influencing B felt. So a pi system has electrons circulating throughout p orbitals, and those moving electrons make an electric current, which then generates a magnetic current. And because of the position of the protons relative to the generated magnetic current, it's essentially adding to B felt. So you have B naught plus B from the pi system, making for a larger felt magnetic field and significant deshielding to push it down between that 5.5 to 8 range. So to recap sort of the whole thing, between about 5 and all the way up to 0, we have protons that are attached to sp3 hybridized carbons. And then below 5, 5.6 down to about 8, you have sp2 hybridized carbons, and it's those protons that you're looking at. So we can think of sort of general ranges. Below about 8-ish, we've got aldehydes, which are very deshielded because of their proximity to the carbonyl carbon, and then carboxylic acids, even lower. Then we can break down the sp3 and sp2 ranges that we've illustrated above. So I'll start from the bottom here. So between about 8 and 7, we've got our protons that are on an aromatic ring. Now, these ranges are all relative. So you could have a proton on an aromatic ring show up at 6.8. Maybe it just has a group that is shielding it and sort of offsetting the pi system. Or it could show up at 8.3 because there's another group that's really deshielding it. So don't be completely married and rigid around 7 to 8. It's a range. And other substituents are going to influence where something shows up in that range. Between about 5.5 and 7 is the proton that is directly on a carbon-carbon double bond, but not part of a cyclic conjugated system. And then between about 5 and 3-ish, you have a proton that's on an sp3 hybridized carbon that's next door to X. So X is what's shifting it downfield a little bit further. And then 2 to 3, I'm going to go up here so I've got a little bit more room. Again, here's our proton. And then the next door neighbor is either a carbon that is sp2 hybridized or a carbon that's attached to a heteroatom but that is less electronegative. So maybe like a nitrogen or a sulfur. And then from about 2 on up, you're looking at carbons that are just attached to other carbons. Maybe they have down the way a heteroatom and that's pulling them more towards that 2. And then remember, a reference point right at 0 is TMS. So that is chemical shift. It is really important that you understand the general areas in which a signal will show up, because that piece of information can really help you differentiate when you're trying to solve a complex problem. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends, and I'll see you next time.